السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, seek His aid and His forgiveness against our evil selves and wrongdoings. He whom Allah guides, there is none to lead astray, and He whom Allah misguides, there is none to guide. I bear witness there is no God worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and messenger. So today, inshallah, we'll talk about a great scholar of the scholars of Islam, a great imam, actually. And when we talk about the imams, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, he is the first imam. And this is something the whole ummah agreed that as Muslims, Ahlul Sunnah, we have many imams, but we recognize four of them mainly: Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. This doesn't mean that there is no other imams, but these imams that who have their madhab and the people followed them during the years, and there was a time even some people, they said al-ijtihad now is closed, and the people, they stopped at that time in the fourth hijra, the fourth century of the hijra, and then after that you find alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, there is people, they said no, we cannot close bab al-ijtihad, because the ilm, the knowledge, is something continuous. You cannot stop it at a certain time. So Imam Abu Hanifa, one of the four imam, and he's the first imam. So what's his name? His name, Abu Hanifa Nu'man bin Thabit bin Zuta. And here you'll find المؤرخين, the historians, they have three opinions about Imam Abu Hanifa. One opinion that Imam Abu Hanifa's grandfather was Mamluk, was a slave, and then his father Thabit also was a slave, but Abu Hanifa himself is not. And the other opinion that Abu Hanifa himself, talking about himself, he said, we were never slaves. So we are originally from Persia and we are free people. And his father Thabit, he came to Imam Khalifa Rabi' Umar Khattab Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh make dua for him that maybe from you come someone who will serve the knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh by or through Abu Hanifa radiallahu anh. The third opinion that you'll find many writers, they spoke about this and they said he's not Persian, he is Arab, and they take his lineage back to some of the Arab tribes at that time. And I found through doing this research that some of the new scholars or new researchers, they are saying that no, definitely he's Persian, and they link this that he was in Iraq at that time, and Iraq, we know, it used to be controlled by the Persians, and many of the Persians became Muslims. So doesn't matter, in my opinion, if he was Persian or Arab, this doesn't change the fact that Abu Hanifa is a great scholar, a great imam. And we know in our history as Muslims that Bilal Habashi from Ethiopia, but he's Mu'addin Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So his origin doesn't change the greatness of Bilal radiallahu anhu. Salman al-Farisi, he's from Persia, And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Salmanu minna, Al al-Bayt. Salman is from us, Al al-Bayt. So his origin is Persian, but this doesn't change the great status that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave to Salman, and so on. And when we talk about his origin, then again, this comes where he is originally from. So some they are saying he's from Kabul, which is in Afghanistan these days, or Babel, or Nisa, or Tirmidh, or Al-Anbar, which is in Iraq. And some they said, why the people, they related him to these places, because they said he moved from place to place, then they aligned him to these areas. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, he narrated from Ismail bin Hamad bin Abi Hanifa. He said, Ana Ismail bin Hamad bin al-Nu'man bin Thad bin al-Nu'man bin al-Marzuban min abna'i Faris al-Ahrar. So he's talking, yani one of his grandsons, he said, I am Ismail, the son of Hamad, the son of Abi Hanifa, and we are from Persia, and we are free people. We are not slaves. And he said, Wallahi ma waqa alayna riqqun qat. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we haven't been enslaved at all. He was born, Imam Abu Hanifa, in the year 80, according to the most of the scholars like Imam Dhahabi and Ibn Hajar. And he started with his father working in the business of selling silk, harir. So his father was very, very famous businessman in that area. And Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu grew up in that environment, the environment of business. So he started doing that business with his father. And he continued like this. Then when his father passed away, he inherited most of his wealth. So his business became bigger and bigger, and he was most of the time busy with this. And one day, Imam Shabi passed him, and he said, what are you doing? He said, look, I am so busy with this business. He said to him, shall I tell you something better than this? He said, what? He said, seek the knowledge. So the words of the Shabi, you know, it went to the heart of Imam Abi Hanifa, rahmahullah. And he started thinking, where shall I start? Because at that time, there is all the knowledge is there. So you'll find, you go to the masjid in Al-Kufa, where he was at that time. So you'll find there is a circle for ulama al-kalam, those who talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tawheed, about and many philosophical things to do with philosophy in Islam. There is another circle for tafsir, another circle for fiqh, another circle for hadith, and so on. So he started with ilm al-kalam. And he found that, you know, this is not what he wants. But he studied there, and he managed to learn a lot of what they call it, ilm al-kalam. And just to clarify this, when we say ilm al-kalam, it is the knowledge that it talks about tawheed in itself in a lot of details about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about this universe, when it started, how it started, about sifat Allah azza wa jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all this stuff. And obviously, at that time, this type of knowledge was spread in that area because they mixed with the Persians and also some of the Romans and the Greeks. And they started to make questions about certain things in the Aqeedah. So you need to have answers for these things. This is how ilm al-kalam started. But Abu Hanifa didn't believe that this is what he wants. Then he looked at the other circles, the tafsir, and he noticed that, mashallah, there is many, they are doing this. Hadith, there is many doing this. Then he found a great sheikh, his name Hamad bin Salam. And that sheikh was teaching fiqh. So he sat in his circle for a few weeks, and he used to ask. Remember that his background is ilm al-kalam. Now, he, for every matter, he needs to discuss it. So Hamad bin Salama noticed that this young man at that time, he's a clever man. So then he started to say, bring Abu Hanifa to sit next to me. So now Hamad bin Salama is teaching and Abu Hanifa is there. And during this time, Abu Hanifa learned a lot from Hamad bin Salama, and he's one of the tabi'een. And when you talk about knowledge at that time, you are talking about one of the great scholars in his time. Then one day, Hamad bin Salama became sick. Now, Hamad bin Salama likes his circle to continue. So what shall he do now? So he said to Abu Hanifa, okay, during these days, you can carry on, you can teach. And Abu Hanifa was a young man, so he was so pleased that his sheikh said to him, now you carry on this. And this is what he's saying in himself, that he thought that he can be the sheikh after Hamad bin Salama, or he can just make a circle. So he said, نَزَعَتْنِي نَفْسِي لِطَلَبِ الرِّئَاسَ فَأَحْبَبْتُ أَنْ أَعْتَزِلَهُ وَأَجِزْ فِي حَلَقَ لِنَفْسِي. So he said, this came, you know, something I started to think about it, and alhamdulillah, I have knowledge now. Why shall I keep listening to Hamad bin Salama? Let me start my circle, then I have my students around me. Then he said, after Hamad bin Salama went for a few days, he started to teach, and the people will come and ask him. So he gave fatawa in 60 mas'ala, 60 matters. So when Imam Hamad bin Salama came back, he said to him, how is it going? He said, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Said, any new masail, any new matters? He said, yes, 60. He said, okay, tell me what. So he said to him, he told him about the 60 mas'ala that Abu Hanifa gave his opinion. So Hamad bin Salama accepted 40 of them, and 20 he disagreed with Imam Abu Hanifa. So Abu Hanifa, he said, if this is the case, I will not move from your circle. Because he found that, yes, 40 is okay, but 20 is wrong. This means that until now, I am not in a position that I can be sheikh, and I can be scholar, I can be teach the people. So I said, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I continue to follow Imam Hamad bin Salama until Hamad bin Salama passed away. Then Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he took his place, and the people started to come to him and learn to him. So when he was 30 years old, he started to give fatwa. Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he was, yani, if we talk about how he looks, he was a beautiful man, and he used to look after his clothes and how he looks. And no wonder about this, brothers and sisters, because you know, he came from the environment of silk, harir. Yani, obviously, he will be a person who will be so interested in the way that he looks and his clothes. And he wasn't so tall or short, as they say, Rabba. من أحسن الناس صورة وأبلغهم نطقا. So when you look at him, mashallah, he's a very smart person. And when he speaks, he is the most eloquent person when he speaks. يحيى بن قطان, he said about him, جلسنا والله أبا حنيفة وسمعنا منه وكنت والله إذا نظرت إليه عرفت في وجهه أنه يتقي الله عز وجل. So he said, we sat with Abu Hanifa and we listened to him. And by Allah, when I look at his face, I will know that this person fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abu Yusuf, one of his students, described him to Harun al-Rashid. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَقُولُ مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ وَهُوَ عِنْدَ لِسَانِ كُلِّ قَائِلٍ كان علمي بأبي حنيفة أنه كان شديد الذب عن محارم الله أن تؤتى شديد الورع أن ينطق في دين الله بما لا يعلم يجب أن يطاع الله ولا يعصى مجانبا لأهل الدنيا في زمانهم لا ينافس في عزها طويل الصمت دائم الفكر على علم واسع. So he reminded us of the ayah ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد, that anything you say, there is two angels, they are recording what you are saying. And he said about Abu Hanifa, this is his student, that he was all the time like to be careful that no one will come near what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram. And he has a lot of taqwa. And he will not say in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with something he doesn't know or has no idea about that. And he likes that the people will obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not disobey him. And he's away from the people of Ahl al-Dunya, those who are running after this dunya. And he will stop talking, silent for long time, thinking a lot. He has a lot of knowledge, and he's not thar-thar, that he's not a chatty person, that he keeps all the time talking with if it is important or not. If he was asked about a mas'ala, a matter, if he has knowledge about it, he will speak about it. If he doesn't know about that mas'ala, then he will say, Allahu سبحانه وتعالى أعلم. أبو حنيفة, brothers and sisters, he was فقيه, but on top of that, he has a lot of ورع. And when we say ورع, we saying that he's a person who tries his best to be away from haram, not the haram only, even the makruh. And when he talks about doing the good things, he's not only doing the right things, he is also doing a lot of nawafil and a lot of warranty things. واسع المال, he has a lot of money, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. And the people, they used to know that he is a very generous person. And one of the examples about his generosity, that his student Abu Yusuf was from a poor family. So all the time during the time when Abu Yusuf was his student, he used to spend on him and give him like, you know, a weekly salary to give to his parents. Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, ما رأيت رجلا أوقر في مجلسه ولا أحسن سمتا وحلما من أبي حنيفة رحمه الله. So Allah Mubarak, again one of the greatest scholars, he said, I didn't see a man with waqar, dignity, and that the minute you see him, you respect him more than Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. And even with the way he looks and he has clothes, that he has the highest level. And when it comes to hulum, and al-hulum, when you are able to revenge or to do something to your opponent, but you stop because you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you love to have your reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Hijr bin Abd al-Jabbar rahimahullah said about him, ما رأى الناس أكرم مجالسة من أبي حنيفة ولا إكراما لأصحابه. That the people, they didn't see anyone that he's so generous to his students more than Abu Hanifa. And when it comes to his companions, he used to give them as much as he can. Imam Abd al-Razzaq, he said, Shahidtu Abu Hanifa fi Masjid al-Khif. This story shows you how patient and how much he follows Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba radwanullahi alayhim. He was in the masjid called Masjid al-Khif. A man came to him and he said, what do you say about this mas'ala? So Abu Hanifa answered him. So that man, he said, but al-Hasan saying so and so. So Abu Hanifa, he said, أخطأ الحسن. So Al-Hasan made a mistake. Then after that, a man came with a mask on his face and he said to Abu Hanifa, are you the one who's saying that Al-Hasan made a mistake? And Al-Hasan, here talks about Al-Hasan al-Basri. He said, yes. Abu Hanifa said, yes, أخطأ الحسن. Hassan al-Basri made a mistake. He said to him, you are the son of so and so and so. Said very nasty words. So Imam Abu Hanifa, just his face was changed. He said, yes. Aywallah, akhta al-Hasan wa asaba ibn Mas'ud. So al-Hasan made a mistake. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who was, as we know, in Al-Kufa, he said the true thing. And this shows you that, in a way, I can say that there is a big link between Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Imam Abu Hanifa. And if you remember, brothers, last year, I did a lecture here about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and his impact in the fiqh and the knowledge in Iraq at that time. And many of the masail that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud made fatwa in, he was different from the other people, but this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him. So here, Imam Abu Hanifa shows you that his opinion was built on what he knew from Abdullah bin Abi Mas'ud. And he used to say, Allahumma man daqa bina sadruh, fa inna qulubana qad ittasa'at lah. So, oh Allah, those people that they find it is difficult for them to accept us, please know that our hearts, they are able to understand these people. And this shows you how great scholar he is. Yani saying that the people, they cannot tolerate, understand what we are saying. And their hearts cannot accept us. But please tell them that our hearts can take all that. And here, he's following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said to Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam, Alam nashrah laka sadrak? And obviously, any da'iyah, any imam, all the prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them this ability that they have big hearts that can take all the trouble, all the things that the people will say, because if they are not like that, then they cannot deliver the message. And Yazid ibn Kumayt said, قال رجل لأبي حنيفة اتق الله. So a man came to Abu Hanifa and he said to him, اتق الله, fear Allah. So Abu Hanifa stood, and you know, you can see his face became yellow. And then he put his head down and he said, Jazakallah khair. The people all the time needs a person to remind them about Allah. Allah Akbar. Yani how many of us brothers, when a person say to them, ittaqillah, respond with saying, Jazakallah khair, barakallah feek, that you reminded me. Some people, they will do this. And others will say, why you are saying to me, ittaqillah, what I've done? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Quran, he said about the people, the arrogant people, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ اتَّقِ اللَّهِ أَخَذَتْهُ الْعِزَّةُ بِالْإِثْمِ. So some people, when you say to them, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his arrogance, he's so proud of himself, he doesn't want to listen. So العزة, that he will be so proud of himself and what he is saying, will prevent him from following the truth. Abu Hanifa used to say, ما صليت صلاة منذ مات حماد إلا استغفرت له مع والدي وإني لأستغفر لمن تعلمت منه علما أو علمته علما. Look at the loyalty. He learned a lot from Hamad bin Salam. Now he'd like to thank Hamad for the knowledge that he gained from him. So he said, every time that I made istighfar to my dad, you see, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. And some people, they think, will say this only if they are passed away. No. It's not necessary. You say, اللَّهُمَّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا when they pass away. Why wouldn't say it when they are alive? Because all of us, we need the rahmah. But the people, they think if you say rahmah Allah, only for the people who passed away. All of us, we need the rahmah. So he's saying that every time I say dua to my dad, I will say in the same time dua to Hamad bin Salama and to anyone who also taught me or I taught him. There is many scholars, they praised Abu Hanifa in his life and after his death. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, said, in Abi Hanifa sahiba hujja wa musaddaq. And here I'd like to mention that Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik, they were in the same time. Abu Hanifa, older than Imam Malik for about 13 years, because Abu Hanifa born 80 and died 150, but Malik was 93. But they met together. Now here the narrations, they are different, but definitely they met. There is no doubt about this, because there is few occasions or stories about this. But did Imam Abu Hanifa, he took knowledge of the hadith from Imam Malik? No, he didn't take knowledge from Imam Malik regarding the hadith. They met, they discussed certain issues together. But we have to remember that Imam Malik was in Medina and Abu Hanifa, he was in Iraq, two different areas. But one of the narrations saying that they met in Hajj and they have a discussion about certain things, which if there is time, I will talk about it, inshallah. So what he said about him, He said, he has hujjah, that if he has a discussion with you, you can find this person, he has the ability to discuss and convince the person that he's discussing. ومصدق, and he's telling the truth. And once he came to Abi Malik, في مجلسه فأكرمه, so he honored him. So when he left Abu Hanifa, they asked him, so who's that man that you gave him this honor? He said, هذا أبو حنيفة. لو جادلكم في أن سارية المسجد من ذهب لأقام عليكم الحجة. So this narration again came from Malik in other place that they asked him about Abu Hanifa. He said, لماذا أبو حنيفة, if he argue with you that the pillar of the masjid is from gold, he will manage to convince you that it is from gold, which shows you how much Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah used to have this ability to argue and make his opinion, make his point, and also can be able to convince the people that he is talking about this. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, he said, لسفيان الثوري, يا أبا عبد الله ما أبعد أبا حنيفة عن الغيبة. So he said to سفيان الثوري, I noticed that Abu Hanifa, he's away from the backbiting. فإني ما سمعته يذكر عدوا له بسوء قط. I didn't hear him talking about any of his enemies in a bad way. فرد سفيان, إن أبا حنيفة أعقل من أن يسلط على حسناته ما يذهب بها. So what the Imam Sufyan al-Thawri said, that Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he is more clever than to give the people his hasanat. Because we know when you backbite, it is as you give your hasanat to the people that they are, that you are biting, backbiting them. This is just a general opinion about Imam Abu Hanifa, about his personality. Now we'll come to the fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa. Obviously, in these minutes, I will not cover the fiqh of Abu Hanifa in general, because this is a very, very big subject, and the people, they are spending years in the universities to learn all these things. But I'll like just to clarify some things about Imam Abu Hanifa, because I've seen, again, while I'm preparing this lecture, there is some people متعصبون جدا. They are taking only one side. And when the name of Abu Hanifa mentioned, they say, who's Abu Hanifa? What he knows? He has nothing to do with fiqh. Nothing. And we cannot rely on him at all. And subhanAllah al-Azim. These type of people, they don't understand how the main scholars, they respect Imam Abu Hanifa and his knowledge. If you open any book of what they call it fiqh muqaran, what I mean by fiqh muqaran, the fiqh that they mention